Dan Hicks is Professor of Contemporary Archaeology at the University of Oxford, curator at the Pitt Rivers Museum, and fellow at St. Cross College, Oxford. He was awarded the 2017 Rivers Memorial Medal by the Royal Anthropological Institute and is author of 6 books, including his most recent and what we'll be discussing today, The Brutish Museums, The Benin Bronzes, Colonial Violence, and Cultural Restitution. Dan, welcome to Novara Media.
Hello, really nice to be here.
Can you tell our audience a little bit about yourself, what your background is, your interests, and how you came to write this book?
Yes, of course. Okay, so the book really, you know, charts a journey that I guess I've gone on as curator at an anthropology museum, at the Pitt Rivers Museum in Oxford, over 13 years. And that 13 years is a time in which the wider conversations over anthropology museums have really changed. But I guess it really began arriving at, you know, Oxford, having done a doctorate and taught in another city, Bristol, where sort of conversations about the legacies of empire were far more advanced, you know, than they were in Oxford. I arrived in 2008 and really found that the conversations that I was expecting to have, you know, you couldn't have in Oxford at that time.
You couldn't have, or they didn't exist.
They didn't exist, and when you tried to have them, actually, this
was not the done thing.
This was not the done, yeah, exactly, it wasn't, yeah. So, you know, I spent those early years in my role as curator really just sort of, you know, aiming to understand what objects were in the collections, you know, diving into the documentation. And then really over those sort of times, you know, as understanding more and more about how how they were formed and their relationship with empire, you know, a big alteration really came in 2015 with the Rosemary's Fall movement. And as the world sort of changed around the museum, you know, I really had to update how able I felt to speak out and, you know, to tell the story, but also maybe to do more than talk, and to look at action, especially in terms of African restitution.
And what was your doctorate in?
So it was in archaeology. I was really looking at the Caribbean and the southwest of England in the early modern into modern periods, you know, looking at the ongoing legacies of empire in the urban infrastructure, but also in the Eastern Caribbean, and how, you know, different layers of those histories, most recently, of course, in the Caribbean with heritage tourism. And at the same time, of course, I was sort of writing that at the end of the 90s, you saw also the tourism industry, you know, re-describing objects in, if you like, you know, what we would call the world culture museums as well. So a part of the book also, it builds on that experience of how the tourist economies have attempted to rebrand and to reimagine, and thereby often to silence a lot of the, you know, really important histories that are in these institutions.
And for anybody who's watching or listening who's not familiar with the Pitt Rivers Museum, it's quite a unique space in terms of sort of these spaces in Britain. Can you briefly sort of explain what it is and what your role is there and how it's somewhat different to most museums people will generally go to?
Well, I think it isn't, absolutely. I mean, it is unlike, you know, most museums that you would visit, but it's not necessarily unlike a whole host of collections which are across the UK, across mm-hmm. Europe, that we just don't see.
Yeah.
So it's a world culture, it's an archaeology and ethnological collection. It was founded in 1884, in the same year as the Berlin Conference and the beginning of the scramble for Africa. And importantly, it was founded at the same moment as the refounding of Oxford's Ashmolean Museum in its sort of new location. So in 1884, you get a division in Oxford of archaeology in between two museums. There's a museum of European objects and sort of civilization, as it were, in the Ashmolean. And in the Pitt Rivers, there's everything else. And this is really a product. It was a gift to the museum by Augustus Henry Lane Fox Pitt Rivers, who was a soldier and who developed a theory of what he called the evolution of a culture from his early work in the 1850s, 1860s, around the improvement of the rifle. So literally, he builds a theory of the cultural evolution, of the evolution of objects, You know, what if cultural objects evolved in the same way as natural things, was his argument. He built that absolutely out of the cutting edge of the most violent, ends of sort of army operations, in the 1850s. So there's always been this link in the Pitt Rivers in between weaponry, sort of warfare and objects that he wasn't the sort of collector that went out around the world himself. He was really, acquiring what sort of washed up in London and elsewhere in Europe, if you like, as empire sort of went on. So then, having been formed in 1884, by the time of events that we're going to be talking about in Nigeria in the late 1890s, the Pitt Rivers was really well set up, not only to receive these sort of goods which were looted, but also to tell a story which ultimately was a story of cultural evolution and thereby white supremacy. So it's really that link which, as anthropologists, we've been so good in some areas of starting to talk about, the role of our discipline in the creation of so-called race science. We've, I think, achieved some, good things in terms of how we've talked about our discipline's role with sort of physical anthropology, skulls, measuring skulls, all that sort of thing. We haven't even started when it comes to talk about appropriation of objects and culture and the cultural displays that showed, equally a different sort of fake, superiority.
So the fact that this is coming into existence the very same year as the Ashmolean Museum, I mean, as you write at length in the book, I mean, it's pretty clear then that the social function here is to make this quite clear cleavage between European and non-European history. What kind of broader purpose does it serve? I mean, and to what extent is that part of a conscious project?
Well, that's right. So obviously, I mean, Ashmolean initially is sort of founded in the 17th century on a different site. And even objects, in the anthropology collections were already in Oxford. There are significant Cook objects from the second and third voyages of Captain Cook. And so obviously, from the 1760s and 70s. But it's this moment in 1884 where there's this realignment and re-establishment of what at the time were very, new and really, cutting edge institutional spaces. These are the redisplay of objects in order to tell a particular story at a particular moment in the development of empire.
How's it different to previously? So obviously Europeans have thought themselves being superior to Africans for a very long time, but what's changing right at the end of the 19th century for this to be?
So it's a link with, I think, evolutionary, ideas over material culture. The idea that objects could evolve, but it's also how fast objects that are taken in acts of violence are finding their way on to display. So it's a matter of weeks in between, if you like, the taking of the Benin objects from royal and sacred objects in between that happening in Nigeria and these objects being displayed in Berlin, in London and also in Oxford. So what do those displays sort of do? Well, they tell the story of a victory and they tell the story of this weird mix of a kind of appreciation of course, art, which is incredible, which, artistic, history that goes back hundreds of years, but sort of as part of that story also says, well, actually, Africans aren't able to look after their own culture. We have removed these objects of sovereignty and we're displaying them here in a different setting. So it creates the idea of the primitive or the barbarous, all these horrible words which are used at the time. But it also, I think, importantly, also served to racialize the visitor as white. So, in order to get access into a late 19th century museum, I guess initially you had to be a certain sort of person. But then even more so, it reinforces a sense of your domination, a sense of the cultural aspects of empire.
And do you think they still serve the same function today? So when people say, oh, the British Museum, and I'm not going to just talk about the British Museum or these sort of great national museums, because the conversation is going to go far beyond that, I hope. But do they say this serve the same function today in terms of reproducing a set of presumptions about white superiority, do you think?
So I think exactly as any other institution which has to deal with the ongoing legacies of empire, you know, that idea that the imperial process is not over, you know, that the decolonizing history is an ongoing one, it's in the present. Of course, exactly like any other institution which is having to fight institutional racism, which is an incredibly white organization, you know, like actually, you know, most of our museums are, we have to face up to and actually, yeah, take action on that sense that, of course, we are working, you know, with a living legacy. Absolutely. There's an interesting moment in 1946. And so when we beat the fascists, one of the first things that happened in Oxford's gallery spaces is the displays of skulls that were there to tell, you know, the racist, you know, narrative of there being different types mm-hmm. of sort of people. They were removed and the skulls were taken off display.
So this is the Pitt Rivers Museum, is it?
This is right next door in the Natural History Museum. Okay, so we're a part of the same building. So they were removed, the skulls, you know, taken off actually into London and are in the vaults now of the Natural History Museum in London. But right next door, the cultural displays weren't really touched because we didn't, as a discipline at that point in the 1940s, I don't think we recognized at that point as a discipline what these displays were and how they were operating in relation to empire. So there's a moment here of understanding that history. There's a reckoning, which is much wider than museums. It's a reckoning with, if you like, the ongoing nature of imperialism. And, you know, that reckoning, you know, my hope, I mean, you know, one of the optimistic, you know, aspects of the book is to say, well, maybe museums as distinctive sorts of public space really offer unique spaces where we can have that conversation and can maybe also try to think of it in terms of a site of conscience, in terms of how to remember, you know, these acts.
Was there a catalyst? Was there sort of a political impetus to get rid of those skulls? Was there a sort of 1940s equivalent of Rhodes Must Fall within the curatorial discipline amongst museums and galleries?
I mean, I think it was simply, you know, good science. You know, the scientists are ahead of us on this as compared to culture workers. You know, scientists understood, actually, this is nonsense. We are a single species. We're not going to display these old Victorian lies, you know, anymore that tell
like
the story
of
difference.
But like you say, this was in 1946, so it's yeah. Clearly there's a changed political context, so it can't just be purely the science, can it?
So it's the science, but also I think there was an atmosphere in the 1920s and 30s mm. in Oxford and other such institutions where such was the fascism, you know, in the environment, that it would have been very hard, I think, right, actively to take those things apart. So in 1946, actually science could win over and the facts of the matter could be stated. I think it's important to remember that to put a display up like that was an act, you know, there was a particular thing going on with the white supremacists from the 1890s into the 1920s, where outdoors in the built environment, statues, but indoors in museums in terms of displays, there was an attempt to naturalize these sorts of, you know, racist lie. And so it's our job really, you know, not to ignore those anymore and to realize they also affect, you know, art and culture as well as only, you know, if you like, sort of natural history.
I'm really grateful you've mentioned the naturalizing element, because it brings together what you touch on in the book as a great similarity, it seems, between Confederate statues in the southern states of the USA and the role of various objects that you might find in the Pitt Rivers Museum. Can you talk about that a bit more? Because for the average person watching or listening to this will say, well, a statue of General E. Lee is quite a clear, provocative political statement saying, I think the abolition of slavery is a bad idea. I think black people are inferior to white people. Whereas a museum seems far less arresting as a political sort of declaration, as a proposition, if you know what I mean. These are people just trying to remember history rather than recreate its meaning. Or is that wrong?
And so I think it's wrong. And I think it's a part of the reason that we know it's wrong is because of the twin, you know, movements, which are, you know, which are African movements, of the fallism movement and the restitution movement. And they have a deep and long history that go back to the 1930s, you know, to Algeria in the 1960s, and have, I think, increasingly in the public mind, you know, around the world in the past year or so, have been joined up, but have always had an interrelationship. So the fallism movement underlining that the naturalization of, you know, white superiority is, you know, dangerous, that something as apparently, you know, banal as a statue, as our built environment, serves really, you know, to make it seem that it was ever thus. In a museum, the same thing can happen. So the role of a curator often is, I think, misunderstood, or we as a profession, you know, misunderstand our role, you know, to keep everything the same, to start as a conservator, you know, to make sure the moths aren't eating the fabrics and that things don't fall apart. But there's this weird extension of that idea to think that our role is to halt history around the museum itself, you know, happening. And in the past years, of course, the world around the Pitt Rivers, and indeed other museums, you know, like it, has changed. So we can see that violence as being, in, you know, I think not only, you know, remembered, not only naturalized, but also reenacted every time we open our doors. So for me, it was the Rose Must Fall movement, Oxford, in 2016. That moment, that observation that the Pitt Rivers is the most violent space in Oxford. You know, for me, that was... This was a tweet from the Rose Must Fall Oxford, you know, movement, an African movement, which had emerged out of the Cape Town, you know, activism. You know, the Pitt Rivers emerged as a really important site as part of the wider conversations and the demands for the decolonisation of Oxford. You know, as a curator, I'd never seen it that way at that point. I really hadn't ever been shown to me as obviously that it isn't just that we need to understand the histories or tell the histories somehow, yeah, better, you know, yeah, but actually even telling the histories, even the presence of these objects can, for many visitors, and indeed a lot of people that will never even set foot inside a museum of this kind, that it is an act of violence that continues the violence of the 19th century. And that was really, for me, you know, the reason I wanted to begin, you know, to dig into the history of actually what happened in Nigeria in the 1890s, and to do, in some ways, really try to do my job better, which is to understand the object, understand how they're understood and valued by other people, and, you know, share knowledge about, you know, what I know and what I can find out.
So given all that, do you think it's fair to say that the museum is a form of weapon?
So that's certainly something that the book, you know, argues. So there, if you go onto the upper floor of the Pitt Rivers, there is a gallery of weapons where the argument that that Pitt Rivers first made from his experience in the Crimean War, where the fact that, you know, that his side, he fought in the Crimean War, his side had rifles and the Russians had muskets, that small alteration in a technology led to a decisive, you know, victory. He extended that idea across by, in actually amazingly, the museum collections, not only of the Royal Armouries, but also of the USI, you know, the organization which is now RUSI, the, you know, right-wing think tank. Yep. Who knew that once upon a time, you know, they had a museum, the United Services Institution.
So for people who aren't aware, RUSI is kind of like Chatham House. It's like a right-wing foreign policy security think tank.
Yep.
They had a museum.
So they had a museum in central London, mm-hmm, and a lot of the objects that were kept there and in the Royal Armouries are now in the Pitt Rivers, because Augustus Henry Lane Fox Pitt Rivers acquired them and assembled them initially in his house and then in a series of displays in East London and then Kensington that told the story of, you know, evolution of objects initially via weaponry. So there was an inherent sense in which sort of violence was there, but actually in reality, what these objects were the things that had been taken from those, you know, indigenous people, Africans, Australians, American, you know, First Nations Americans, who had been defeated in war, you know, by the British over the previous 200 years or so.
And can I just interrupt? I'm sorry, but you said Henry Lane Fox is this chap.
Yeah, Augustus Henry Lane Fox,
and
yeah.
There's a Robin Lane Fox and a Martha Lane Fox in British civil society today. Are they descendants of his?
They are relations of his, yeah. There's a very complicated family history.
It's still quite a prestigious family and sort of amongst the British establishment.
So there's the Lane Fox side and there's the Pitt Rivers side as well, of course, who continue to own the estate on.
So we are very much still Grumble living Chess. In that world. There's a think tank that had this museum. Their descendants are still, figures in British society. This is not, 500-600 years ago. This is very much a world we've inhabited, inherited.
So I think the really important thing about the Benin, attack is how recent it was. 1897, the book goes into the restitution, one of the early sort of recent wave of restitutions, which is from a private individual who inherited objects that were looted by, inherited immediately from his father, from his father. So it's the grandfather of a man who's alive now served in that expedition. The fact it's that near in family, histories, and that Mark Walker is absolutely attempting now, to do the right thing by returning those objects. That shows us what's going on in that family. History is something that's also important for institutions and indeed maybe more generally for society. It is incredibly near in terms of our history. And yet, it's so interesting. How do we not understand the histories of, the late 19th century? I mean, often when we think about the role of the UK in international relations, in international warfare, international actions, we often, like the National Trust is at the moment, you talk about abolition and emancipation. And then there's this big sort of Queen Victoria-sized sort of gap often. And then all of a sudden you're World War I and it's 1914. And yet in every year of Victoria's reign, from the 1830s up until 1901, there were what the Victorians called the Little Wars. And as well as we're here, actually the Little Wars, of which obviously the attack in Nigeria was... it was only one of them. They weren't little. They were serious operations. And they were, largely in Africa, but also in other parts of the world. They were really involved in the corporate world. They were involved in a new level of your technology on the military side. And they were about the dispossession of Africa, at a wholly new level. So that dispossession, as I've learned, was not only about, as it was earlier, about human beings under the Atlantic trade. It wasn't only about land. It wasn't only about goods. It was also about art. And weirdly, art and its display for racist purposes in the West found its way as a key part of that way in which Africa was robbed as a continent.
So there's two things. I mean, often you'll hear in conversations about the period preceding the First World War, about how from the Congress of Vienna, 1815, all the way through to 1914, the First World War, people say this was the longest period of protracted peace in European history. Yeah. This speaks to the balance of powers and the multilateral system that held together peace in Europe. And what you're saying is this masks a great deal of violence merely because it was inflicted on places beyond Europe.
Well, it's amazing that we're able to tell in such intimate detail each of the battles, each of the moment, on a sort of day-by-day basis, instance in the First World War and the Second World War. And yet, only a matter of years earlier, often the same soldiers had been serving in Africa that found their way in, the First World War. We're unable, who has heard of these various expeditions in Uganda, the Bunyoro expedition of 1892 in Uganda, you know, who has heard of the Battle of Omdurman in Sudan, who has thought about the bombardment of Zanzibar. Yeah, yeah, Churchill is all, yeah, I mean, they're all, yeah, Baden-Powell is in some of these, in the Ashanti, you know. Yeah, I mean, there's a whole social class of, you know, those individuals that are later officers in the 20th century who are making early appearances in the historical records, you know, in these African conflicts. I mean, this was a major operation that was going on. It was a big part of, you know, military activity, you know, naval, of course, in the case of the Benin expedition and also army in terms of Ashanti and others.
Let's talk about the Benin punitive expedition. But I just want to quickly say the formulation here, I don't know where it comes from, whose it is, but you say effectively this expedition takes place within the context of World War Zero.
Yeah.
So we know about World War One, we know about World War Two, but you're saying really, correct me if I'm wrong here, really from maybe the mid-1880s all the way through to the early 20th century, there's this World War Zero. What does that mean, and who are the people fighting it, and what's it over?
So, I mean, you know, we do, I think, as a culture and a society, understand something of 1884, the Berlin Congress, that idea of the scramble for Africa in that, you know, euphemistic sort of term that we use. I mean, it sounds, you know, relatively unoffensive, doesn't it? The scramble was just to see who could carve something out on some abstract map. Whereas, of course, the physical scramble and the carving out involved actually, you know, very much not simply, you know, redrawing a map, but a whole host of operations, which importantly saw the reemergence of the company, you know. So we'd had, I mean, we were aware in the 17th century for slavery of the role of the Royal Africa Company, as indeed we were reminded of in, you know, Bristol only recently with that late 19th century commemoration of Colston, who was involved in that. I think we're aware also of the importance of the East India Company, which of course was shut down earlier in the 19th century.
1857,
right? Because of how horrific, you know, the level of violence, the level of the dispossession that corporate colonialism involved. But then in the later 19th century, in, you know, most obviously maybe in terms of recent conversations, you know, Cecil Rhodes' activity with the South Africa Company, but also activity in East Africa and, you know, importantly for West Africa, the Royal Niger Company. The founding of this, the role of this sort of corporate interest in the founding of the protectorate, in the extraction and the development of the palm oil trade, of the rubber trade, to some degree of the ivory trade, the corporate nature of empire in the wake of 1884 leads really to what I have called in the book World War Zero, that 30-year period in between 1884 and 1914, when so much of this military, you know, activity happened. In the case of the Benin expedition, because there aren't the historical records, I do my best to count up through simply the bullet count, through simply how many Maxim, you know, machine guns there were, how many rocket launchers, how many of the warships were involved.
1890s is incredibly sophisticated military technology.
It is. That's exactly right. And so the warships, and of course, remember, the, you know, these Admiralty activities, which are in the case of the Nigeria attack, but also a number of other attacks that, yeah, that happened. This was the sort of, you know, the ongoing, this was the ongoing, you know, naval operation that had begun to suppress Atlantic trade after abolition, you know, in 1807. But there's this kind of mission creep for that naval operation.
I want to come back to this.
And so, yeah, but certainly the scale of what happens in 1897 and a number of other activities, you know, really under the coalition government of 1895, yeah, to 1900. So they're a really nasty bunch of people that end up in charge of this country. Salisbury as your prime minister, and then as the essentially a Chamberlain, you know, involved as well. They really, in the final years of Victoria, in an attempt to celebrate her jubilee year in 1897, it's just a land grab. Well, not only a land grab, it's this enormous, you know, attack upon West Africa, upon other parts of Africa. The sheer level of violence, it's a new peak. So that's what I'm saying is really, you know, World War Zero.
A sublime of violence almost. It does feel like just this is kind of unprecedented in terms of intensity and the asymmetry of capacity. Is just, it's hard to imagine. Maybe 15th century, 16th century in the Western Hemisphere, in the Americas.
Well, a lot of it is really the invention of the machine gun.
Yeah. So you talk about, and this is an issue, it's a punitive expedition. It's done because I think 9 British soldiers are killed.
Well, I mean, the book actually queries how many people were killed, but a small number of personnel were killed.
And in retaliation, how many bullets are used from these Maxim guns?
If we count the whole bullets across, not only the Maxim guns, but the rifles, but all of the bullets, we're talking 3 million or so are involved in this expedition.
And so how many casualties could we be looking at, sort of a realistic estimate?
So really, you know, one of the things that I thought that really, you know, came to mind a lot in the writing of the book was Michelle Wolf Trillo's idea of silencing the past. There is silence in terms of the casualties, in terms of the refugees, in terms of the deaths. We can only estimate. And of course, what Trullo said was that to silence the past is akin to silencing a gun. The silences aren't just omissions, they are acts. To not say something is as much a speech act as really to say something. So we can only do our best, you know, to attempt to work out those numbers. For the Northern Nigeria operation, which I go into, that happens at the same moment in time, we're fairly sure we're talking about the tens of thousands. That was a very different sort of warfare where, you know, the cavalry, essentially a medieval technology, is just mown down by, you know, machine guns. The sheer numbers in the jungle warfare, the bush warfare, are hard to tell. But, you know, almost certainly, and the book goes into this in some detail, we're talking tens of thousands.
They are just shooting sort of with complete indifference into jungle.
Into the jungle and advancing, and they're clearing the bush, and they're moving ahead and just, you know, volley firing, and they're using the machine gun to, you know, to rake, you know, whatever is there. And of course, this is, you know, yeah, remember, the kingdom has been working, has, you know, treaties have been signed, you know, the king, you know, the Oba, as he's known, has been working with the British in a whole host of different ways. And suddenly there's this attempt to remove sort of sovereignty. So of course, the Bini people are rising up in order to attempt to essentially a fight back, you know. So the numbers, yeah, we expect are in the tens of thousands.
And very quickly, what was the Kingdom of Benin at this time? What area did it sort of comprise? How large was it? And what happened once these soldiers got to the capital city itself, Benin City?
Yeah, so the Benin Kingdom is, you know, one of a number of, you know, West African kingdoms that emerged in, you know, a phase of urbanization that dates right the way back, you know, to the 15th century. You know, the first Oba and the, you know, the long line of Obas is earlier than Elizabeth I. You know, this is a long tradition of sort of sovereignty. And the art and the making of art was a key part of this royal sacred landscape where the ancestral homes of the Obas are retained in ruinous form, and altars are set up with the famous heads and the plaques, but also your carved ivory tusks that tell the history of the Obas, a whole set of other, you know, just amazing art. So this is a sacred landscape. It's a, you know, which is at the heart of, you know, the kingdom. And so the attack upon it really is an act of, if you like, yeah, desecration, as much as it's also an act of extreme, you know, ultra violence against people. And the taking of those objects, the taking of those ancestral objects from this, yeah, civilization, you know, I mean, absolutely, you know, without a doubt, these West African, you know, kingdoms were incredibly, you know, sophisticated and, you know, to turn, as the book says, to turn them into archaeology. This is what that act of violence did. The coming together of the museum and the gun served to say, well, actually, if we just kill everybody and we take all their art and we display it in a museum, alongside and initially in the British Museum, you know, these objects are on display in Assyrian and Egyptian galleries. So like, oh yeah, you know, the argument is, well, really the kingdom is now just like the ancient, you know, like ancient Egypt.
It's antiquity.
So there's what I call a chronopolitics here, whereby the lie that Africa is in the past and not in the present, which is still with us as an idea, starts with the use of the museum in order to display a living culture as if it was dead, hand in hand with actual death.
And they sack the city, they destroy the city, they loot all these objects. I mean, I suppose the analog would be if somebody were to go into Florence and burn down the Piazza della Signoria, all the palazzi, take all the paintings and the statues and say, well, this was all a very long time ago, you know.
Well, that's right. But also the thing that actually I found most upsetting about the research for the book, because I hadn't actually realized this. I'd always been told, and I believed what I'd been told, that there was a kind of cruel logic to the looting, because the looting was then used to defray the costs of an expedition that had been necessary because it was a punishment for an earlier infraction. Now, having looked at it, researched the book and written it, I understand a series of things about this. Number one, the idea of the punitive expedition was only a pretext, and it was a pretext. It's an ideology, which I call white projection, the sort of your projection upon others of your own violence, of your own barbarism. It's an argument, it's an idea that finds its way all the way into the 20th century to Ireland and to Kenya in the idea of the reprisal. At the same time, there is that sense that, not only is it an act of reprisal and a fake pretext, but also the looting was absolutely a free-for-all. It was chaotic. A tiny number of the plaques ended up in the British Museum. 200 are now on display. A further 100 were sold. That's out of 10,000 objects that were taken, largely by individuals, soldiers that kept them, sold them for money, and they ended up in, and indeed even into museums. And the museums are then sold off, themselves. So the history of these 10,000 objects, the sheer violence of that attack, then leads into a shattering of this art to 150 and more, locations around the world. And that's the context in which I then, in the book, come to the question of the return of these artworks.
So when World War Zero is happening, 1890s, end of the 19th century, great deal of war making, militarism, how does that relate to a kind of a humanitarian underpinning, a license to do all of these things?
So that certainly, and I think there really are echoes of more recent years. What seems to be going on in the 1890s is that part of the pretext is not only some incident in which some people may or may not have been killed, but also more general existential questions of the existence of slavery, the sense of your traditional religion existing rather than Christianity. So these are this sense that Africans need to be helped is really constantly used as a refrain to justify such enormous levels of violence. So I think being aware of that role, even the squadron itself was known as which undertook this work was historically known as, if you like, the squadron was known as the humanitarian squadron. So that I think something that we're aware of in more recent years, that there is a militarist angle to the humanitarian sort of movement, actually is here. There's a kernel of that here in the 1890s.
There's obviously been a lot of talk in recent months and years, particularly with the Edward Colston statue, that actually Britain was responsible for ending the slave trade And yet what you're saying here is that even in ending the slave trade, even in sort of being sort of the military instrument of abolitionism abroad, this leads to a great deal of violence and suffering on the behalf of black people, fundamentally.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, you know, there is a right-wing narrative out there that talks about the sacrifices made, you know, by the Royal Navy to end slavery, to continue that work. But of course, what it misses is the mission creep of the humanitarian squadron, as it was, you know, known, with, you know, no hint of irony, as they increasingly started to attack, to bombard, to patrol up and down rivers, and to have this role really for maintaining your trade as and sort of instigating trade, this corporate role, you know, as the years went on.
And they're constantly using it as a license for regime change. That's what we would call it today, isn't it?
That's really absolutely right. So that interesting interaction in certain contexts of informal empire or indirect rule, however we would refer to the protectorates and these sorts of, you know, they're not quite colonial sort of setups. They're just on the border of that. And in those sort of border zones, you get these activities in which, yeah, the you know, the argument always is that, you know, that people, you know, need to be, you know, kept in line, and, you know, the military force has a key role in that. So yeah, that sort of, yeah, mission creep of the humanitarian squadron is a really, yeah, central element of the book.
Finally, and this is, I presume, the reason why you've written the book, is there's obviously a big conversation right now about what you refer to as restitution, cultural restitution in the book. And in this country in particular, but across Europe, across the global north, there are many of these spaces with objects which have been stolen from elsewhere. We've just talked about how that's tantamount to a form of weapon. Should a museum like the Pitt Rivers Museum even exist? And if it should exist, and that's a moral should, what kind of space should it be?
Yeah. So, I mean, I really feel we've never needed something like a World Culture Museum, you know, more than we do now. We need spaces where we can celebrate and understand art and sort of culture outside of the conventional, you know, Eurocentric lens. But that doesn't mean that period of time in the past when these institutions were turned into devices for oppression, for robbery, it doesn't mean that should be okay, that's okay, that we just ignore it. And indeed, it doesn't mean that the people who are trying to undo, to dismantle, to repurpose, to reimagine these institutions, that doesn't mean that we are attacking the institution in terms of its existence. What we're doing, exactly like anyone attempting to reform and to address institutional racism, you know, to face up, you know, to the past and to take action on that, actually we're just attempting to do our job. We're trying to be the curators who, of course, you know, have to be, you know that idea that the museum's always got to remain the same is a surprisingly recent idea. It's an idea that comes out, as the book says, in the wake of your 9/11, when you've got, you know, the cultural world being instrumentalized for a particular Blairite or a Bush Blair idea of, you know, the museum as a meeting space for cultures that just, you know, not only hides but also sort of reignites the relationship in between the museum and your corporate, you know, empire and that extractivist, you know, mode of thinking. So yeah, it's a case by case basis, but of course we need to give things back when they're asked for, and we need to be much better at sharing the knowledge of what is in the collections. Here in the UK, you're never more than 100 miles away from a looted African object. And this is a conversation we need to have. A big argument in the book is, let's absolutely, you know, decenter the most powerful, the most well-funded and the loudest institutions in this conversation, in the British Museum, you know, New York or wherever. Let's have this conversation in the regions. Let's see the Benin objects in the regions, in from sort of Derby to you know, Edinburgh, from Oxford and Cambridge to Bristol and Exeter. Let's have a national conversation about actually why these objects are here and how we can return them.
And you want to decolonize the museum. That's the word we keep on hearing, decolonize. Is there a risk that this becomes subsumed within broader categories like inclusivity or diversity? Because decolonizing a museum is a pretty radical path to go down, isn't it?
Well, I'd say for a lot of, I mean, it's a word that is loved by many museum directors. And for that reason, we need to be incredibly cautious and suspicious of this term. I don't actually use the term. I talk about restitution. I talk in the book, and indeed in my working life, I talk about the positive action we need to take to diversify our sector, to start to look like, and indeed, yeah, really to represent the communities that we claim we serve. That's how we begin to dismantle the white infrastructure, which is anthropology.
So you would reject the idea of decolonizing a museum? Because I think you talk about a post-colonial museum, and so I view that as kind of interchangeable. But I think there's
there are some national museums that will tell you that the decolonization of a museum is about holding on to stuff, but sort of you're telling the story better. Mm-hmm. Lots of, you know, rewrite the label. You know, that is not what I mean. I'm talking about, I mean, the words I choose to use are to dismantle, to repurpose, and to reimagine. You know, I think, of course, the decolonial movement as it started in Africa, the anti-colonial movement, you know, is incredibly important. But there's a generational shift. You know, what Achille Mbembe calls a negative moment, which is the moment at which the Rose Must Fall movement happened, which was a generation after apartheid. Right, that, and yet, you know, inequalities are there still. And he talks about the negative moment emerging when long-standing inequalities are there and further inequality is layered upon that. Here in museums, we have the same issues. So it's being led by African voices. It's, you know, our job as the curators is to share, understand what's in the museums and share that knowledge, and then to listen and to take action on what Africans ask for. You know, writing this book, I guess I had to address the question of who cares about art? You know, what is this, some sideshow to the really important work of how to address racism, the ongoing effects of empire in our museums? Whereas actually what I found out is that in this case, art had a central role to play in world history. Art was actually used as a form of, you know, racial violence, as a part of the wider dispossession of Africa. And so its return now and the restitution movement is a key element that all of us on the left actually really need to be fighting for.
That's a great way to end it. Dan, your new book is out, I think it was this week, wasn't it? In all good bookstores. Focus particularly on Benin, but I think for anybody interested more broadly in that restitution movement, I think it's a great place to start. If you've enjoyed this video and you want to see more like it, you want to support our work, please go to novaramedia.com/support. Make a one-off payment or a monthly subscription. We like to ask for, I think, 1 hour's waged work a month. We really appreciate it. It helps us to produce more of this content. And of course, we're going into 2021, which, if it's plausible, could be even worse than 2020. There's never been a more important time to create a new media for a different politics to platform precisely conversations like the one we've had today. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dan. Best of luck with the book.
Thank you.
My name's Aaron Bastani, and you've been watching Novara Media.